One of the most common myths surrounds the fear of organ donation.
Why do people refuse to donate their own organs? Or even more commonly, refuse to let their relatives' organs and tissues be donated? There's a lot of reasons. In some cases, they say they suffered enough.
We just have so many families that have seen medical dramas, and the way that organ donation is portrayed in those dramas isn't always so wonderful. So they imagine the body being cut up, and they talk to us about how they want their loved one to be left alone, and they've already suffered enough.
They have a mistaken idea about what organ and tissue donation is all about. They think it's done in a very ghoulish manner, but it's not. Tissue donation doesn't even leave any types of scars or types of observable changes. Even if the body is shown in an open casket and people can file by the casket, even experienced funeral directors, and they can't tell that the organs and tissues have been taken.
In fact, organ transplantation is less invasive than the common American practice of embalming, which involves draining and replacing bodily fluids, stuffing and sewing body cavities, and other elaborate manipulations of the corpse.
A lot of people think that donation is against their religion, and I can't really explain where that comes from, but there's no mainstream religion in the United States that is in any way against donation. In fact, all of the major ones that I can think of have come out in support of donation, saying that it's the ultimate act of brotherhood. Most healthcare and medicine starts with somebody who's not well, and they progress through life and then they die. The interesting thing I think about organ donation is that we start with death and we turn that into life.
My son Shaun was riding in a rodeo. It was on a Saturday night, and about 11 o'clock we had been out, and we came back home, and about 11 o'clock we got a call, you know, saying that he'd been in an accident. Care flight helicopter made him there, and then we all, you know, headed to Baylor. Probably about an hour or so later, the neurosurgeon there came out and told us, you know, that he had a massive head injury, and it was one of the worst that he had seen. It was, you know, equivalent to, you know, like trauma in a car wreck or something like that. We pretty much knew that there wasn't going to be any way to, you know, for him to come out of it.
The reason I needed to have a transplant was about 11 years ago, I was diagnosed with scleroderma, and the scleroderma eventually went to my lungs, and after a period of time, my heart and efforts to pump the blood through the lungs wore itself out, and I had heart failure. So not only did I need two lungs, I needed a new heart. I waited almost 2 years for a transplant, and there were times when I thought during big occasions like a holiday, I'd say, you know, I'm sick this year, but by next year, I'm going to be okay. Well, the next year came and I wasn't. So it was hard to stay positive.
And we had talked, me and the boys, I know, had talked a couple times about that subject, you know, just in general conversation, you know, and I pretty much knew what their feelings were on it. I had really mixed feelings about it up to that point. But when that occurred and we knew that there was no chance of him coming out of it, there was no question in my mind that was the thing that we needed to do.
And about 8 o'clock in the evening, two nurses came in, Richard and Ann, and Richard said to me, "Hey, Darla, what are you doing tonight?" Which I thought was kind of an odd question because I'd been in the hospital for 7 weeks. So I just said, "Richard, I think I'm getting ready to go to bed." And he said, "We have your organs." They wheeled me out of the room at 10 o'clock that evening, and the surgery was a go at 11, and I came out between 4 and 5 the next morning with a new heart and two new lungs.
It was just incredible to know that they can do that. And just to see her and to know that he lived inside of her, it was almost a spiritual thing.
I'm very grateful for the Harpers for the gift they gave me. I have never been more in love with my life or happier than these last 4.5 years since the transplant. I don't have to concentrate on breathing. I don't have to concentrate on taking the next step. It's an amazing thing. I've seen three nephews born in that period of time, and one of my nephews is actually named after Shaun Harper Harding. I can't even imagine what it's like to lose a son, a 17-year-old son. He never really had a chance to grow up. And at a very difficult time, they decided that they wanted to help other people. And, you know, I can't ever thank them enough. And I'm sorry they lost their son, but I'm also very grateful that they were willing to donate to help someone else.
I think it makes the grieving process a little easier because you know that he is living on, even though it's in someone else.
For me, just seeing someone else benefit from his death is a great relief. It's a great comfort, I guess.
We have 80,000 people in this country waiting, and we only have about 20,000 transplants, organs available each year to do transplants with. If there was ever a possibility that we could get enough organs donated to fill the need that we have, it would be an amazing thing because that means people on the waiting list would stop dying.
It's never too early to start talking or thinking about being a donor.
They don't have to go anywhere, get anything, sign anything, or do anything. It simply comes down to making the decision and sharing that decision with your family.
It's almost always going to be up to relatives to say yes or no. In fact, it's said that you can die with a signed organ donor card in every pocket and one pasted to your forehead, and if your relatives don't agree, you won't get to donate.
Make sure that a family member knows, whoever would be there at the time of your passing, make sure that they know what your wishes are, because someone needs to talk on your behalf when you can no longer talk for yourself.
I hope to experience my own death with gratitude for all that I've been given.
I'd like to experience my own death having taken care of the practical issues, so that I don't need to worry about leaving loose ends behind me.
I would like it to be like my mom. I would like it to be in the surroundings of love and in light.
I'm not scared of death. It's all the dying process beforehand that is something I don't ever want to have to go through again.
I don't want to sleep through my death. I want to be awake for it. I think it's the adventure of a lifetime. And I don't want to miss a moment of it.